It was about 1916. I was at college going, taking a course in mechanical engineering back at Cornell University in New York. And this was, I took a job at the studio to earn money during summer vacation. And it just happened that Doug Fairbanks was making a picture in the East, and he wanted a modern setting. And I'd had about 7 years of architecture. The man who did all the sets and did that kind of stuff was down in Arizona, and they didn't know what to do. And I said, I can draw, get him a set. So I made the set, and Doug came back and he looked at it and he said, this is just what I wanted. Who the hell did this? And they introduced me to him, and he looked at me and he said, you look like you might be a pretty good athlete. And I said, I am. What do you do? And I said, well, I'm a 4 handicap at golf, and I was junior champion playing tennis. And oh, hell, he said, come on out and play with me this next weekend. We became good friends. And he was going through the courtship stage with Mary Pickford. And he said to Mary, why don't you put Howard in as your real property man? She said, okay. And I did a couple of things that she liked, so she made me her assistant director. And one day the director got drunk and she said, I guess we can't work any. And I said, why don't we make some scenes? And she said, can you do it? And I said, sure. And we made some scenes and she was very pleased with them. And that was my start as a director.
Palm Springs, Kalifornien, November 1977. 5 Tage mit Howard Hawks. Der Mann, der zwischen 1926 und 1970 40 Filme drehte, war einer der besten Regisseure des amerikanischen Kinos. Er machte Western wie Red River und Rio Bravo, Komödien wie Leoparden küsst man nicht und Blondinen bevorzugt, Abenteuerfilme wie Haben und Nichthaben und Hatari, schwarze Gangster- und Kriminalfilme wie Scarface und Tote schlafen fest. Fast alle klassischen Genres Hollywoods verdanken ihm Meisterwerke. Schauspieler wie John Wayne, Gary Cooper und Cary Grant führte er zu den Höhepunkten ihrer Karriere.
I came back from after the war and we'd had quite a long time of it. My brother and I took a house over in Hollywood. We met a lot of Hollywood people, and one director asked me if I could help him write the titles during the time when you had printed titles. I said, sure, and I did them, and he was so pleased about them that I got well paid, and the next day there were 2 or 3 others wanting to have titles written. So I immediately jumped into a pretty well-paying job. You got $2,000 or $3,000 for writing the titles, and I could write titles for a picture in 2 days, so that was pretty good. About that time, I realized how little I knew about pictures, and I went to see a picture every night, and sometimes two, and sometimes I saw the same one 2 times or 3 times. And I went to mostly pictures that were directed by good directors. And I think I learned quite a little bit, and I've got a good memory, so I've had no trouble from that time on figuring out where the camera ought to go, what you should do, and telling a story. Because in my opinion, the director is just a storyteller. And he ought to use the best way photographically and the best way with titles, and the best way with action that he can tell a story. And the people met Saturday night, everybody in the motion picture business would go down to a place called Vernon, run by a character called Baron Long. And it started out in the evenings very calmly, but they became rather uncommonly. There was an Indian star who used to get a little tight, and he'd start running around the cafe, but he'd run on the tops of tables, and they couldn't catch him. And I belonged to a fraternity, and the fraternity came and wanted to go out there, and I walked in, and I think, I don't know, some overzealous fellow was going to throw me out, but I had 50 guys behind me, and we got in without any trouble at all. But there was another place called Sunset Inn, and there the people dressed up more, and Paul Whiteman played the music, and another place that started after was called the Plantation. And outside of a fight once in a while, they were pretty nice places.
An einem Sonntag fährt der 81-Jährige 3 Stunden durch die Wüste zum Autorennen nach Willow Springs, um seinen Sohn Greg beim Training zu beobachten. In den 20er Jahren ist Hawk selber Rennen gefahren.
It was fun driving, a lot of dust. I drove in one race and there was an old fellow, he asked me, he said, have you ever driven in a dusty race? And I said, no. He said, that fellow over there is awful good in dust. You hook onto his tail and count the number of laps you do, and then pass him and win the race. I said, okay. We passed an awful lot of cars. We were going along, and all of a sudden it got awful kind of bumpy, and trees were going by right on one side. He'd gone through the fence, and I was following him out through a cornfield. When I stopped, he said, God, I never knew when you were going to stop. I said, I was afraid to stop. But it was a lot of fun driving in those days.
Von Autorennen handeln die Hawks-Filme The Crowd Roars und Rote Linie 7000. The Crowd Roars entstand 1932 mit James Cagney in der Hauptrolle.
I had about 8 Indianapolis winners working in the picture, driving in the picture, and they'd do anything. And we had good cars, and we had the 2 Duesenberg brothers working as mechanics to make things. At Indianapolis, we had a hitch that went on a race car out in front and dragged another race car with a couple of dummies in it. And you could release that, and 5 seconds later, a wheel came off, and the car would just go flying into the air, and we got some marvelous things. We were making a scene of a car wrecked and smoke was drifting across the track. And it was very funny to see these good drivers. None of them could believe which way they were going. When they came out of the smoke, they came out sideways and everything. We laughed about it a lot. But they could do amazing things. There was one fellow I rode with around the track a few times. He was completely blindfolded. And we were probably doing 120 miles an hour. And he would say, "We are going to pass a fence post with a beer can on it now," and it'd be right there. He knew every foot of the track. He could drive just about as well without eyes as he could with eyes. I was in an automobile race, and there was a fellow going pretty good. I was out in the front, and he tried to pass me, and I put him through the fence. And I looked around and I saw him. He wasn't looking where he was going or anything. He was just doing this to me. I won the race and I saw him coming walking down the track afterwards. And I said, "Oh, here's a fight." The fellow came up to me and he said, "You're pretty good." But he said, "Don't ever try it again, because I'll run right into you." And I liked him and he liked me. And it was Victor Fleming, the director, who made Gone with the Wind and everything. I've forgotten just why it was, but he was away, and I knew he didn't want to be in a certain, in the house that he had been. I moved all his stuff up the house, and he stayed 5 years. I call it the love story between two men. I've used it quite a few times in making pictures. I steal from myself because I know quite a little bit about telling that story. I used it first with Gable and Tracy in the aeroplane picture. I wrote it, Vic Fleming directed it. It was used again with Spencer Tracy and a young boy in a great picture. I've forgotten what it was. I used it in my first picture called A Girl in Every Port. I can't remember all the times that I've used it, Mikey, and it always stays good. There's a great loyalty between the friendship of the characters. And they would probably fight if someone said anything about the other man. It's just a peculiarity of the characters that I try to do.
1941 drehte Hawks den Kriegsfilm Sergeant York mit Gary Cooper, die Geschichte eines pazifistischen Farmers, der ein berühmter Soldat wird. Jesse Lasky, der Produzent dieses Films, war ein alter Freund des Regisseurs.
I'd been sent a script, and Jesse Lasky, the former head of Paramount, was the producer. And they said, "If you don't do this picture, why, we're going to make a B picture out of it." So I went over to see Lasky in his office, and he had the shakes, he needed a shave. And I said, "Jesse, I know you, and I know you're one of the best producers going, because you had such an eye for an ear for a good story. Will you close the telephone, shut it off, tell them we're not to be interrupted, and tell me why you bought this damn story?" He told me a completely different story than the one in the script. I said, "Have you got any objections to my changing your story?" He said, "You can do anything you want with it." I said, "Would you like to have Gary Cooper?" He said, "We can't get him. We tried it." So I called up Coop and said, didn't Jesse Lasky give you your first job? He said, yes. And I said, well, he gave me my first job. And I just saw him, and he needs a shave, and he's got the shakes, and he's got a picture, and I don't think it would hurt you or me to do it. He said, I'll come over and talk to you. So he came over in about 10 minutes. He came in, and he didn't say a word about this. He just talked about a new gun that I had. And finally, I said, look, Coop, you have to talk about this thing. He said, what's there to talk about? You know we're going to make the picture, don't you? I said, okay, you come over with me to Warner Brothers, and if I say, isn't that right, Mr. Cooper, you say, yep. And then we went over there, and I told Jack Warner we'd make the picture if they let us alone. Isn't that right, Mr. Cooper? He said, yep. And I said, really alone? We're going to rewrite the story. I want to make it the way I want to make it. And I don't want any interference. And isn't that right, Mr. Cooper? He said, yes.
Mit Gary Cooper machte Hawks drei Filme.
Well, Cooper and I were very good friends. But he liked to shoot. He didn't shoot well with a shotgun, but he did with a rifle. We each of us experimented with high-velocity rifles. And we had we were very good friends. I made two pictures, I think it was, with him. He got an Academy Award out of a picture that I made called Sergeant York. I told him his best scene was when he fell asleep on the bed and his mother played an emotional scene and never woke him up.
Hawks und John Ford, 1966.
I used to talk to him and kid him about it, I'd say. Well, you know, that junk that you make is where you get so damn sentimental and everything. And he said, I know it, but I can't get as nasty as you do. And we used to talk to each other that way. But he liked my pictures and I liked his. I told him his stuff was corny. But it was good corn, great corn. I remember that in Red River, he liked a great, big, tall guy who started the stampede, and he was always sticking his finger in the sugar jar and stealing sugar. So I used that as the start of the stampede. Ford thought he was really good. And I said, Jack, he really is no good as an actor. It took us 4 days to get a scene with him. And he said to John Wayne, he said, Hard's trying to keep me from using that actor. So he used the actor, and then he said, why didn't Hard tell me it was no good? But we had a lot of fun together. When I made pictures of John Wayne, he'd always come down on location and stay for 2 or 3 weeks and play poker, drink a little scotch.
Mit John Wayne drehte Hawks seine 4 Western, Red River, Rio Bravo, El Dorado, Rio Lobo und den Tierfängerfilm Hatari.
Well, Wayne could ride. I thought he was good. And he did everything I wanted him to do. Well, that's a present from John Wayne. I gave him and made for him a belt buckle representing Red River, and he's worn it in every picture that he's made since that time. So he just decided that he was going to give me one, but he was going to give me one that I couldn't wear. I had to put it up, and that's why that's so big. Well, this hat has quite a history. Gary Cooper gave it to me. Before he gave it to me, he put it out on his front lawn on a post, and the spiders built their nests in it, and it got weathered, really weathered looking. When we made Red River, I loaned it to Monty Clift. And it's been a good luck piece for a number of people that I've loaned it to. They've all done well. And it hasn't changed or anything. Nothing happens to it. It still remains the same way. I've always been doing two or three things when I've been working. Every time I get bored writing a scene, I turn around and work on something in wood, something in metal, something in silver, or anything like that, to keep from getting bored. I didn't have much to do with the Hollywood crowd. I had a lot of things that were more fun, like getting out. I had horses, I'd ride, I'd go shooting, play tennis, play golf. And when you've done that all day, you don't want to sit up all night, you know, getting tight or something like that. So I never have mingled very much. Some of them, like Gable, Cooper, Bogart, people like that, the ones that I liked, I'd meet them, ask them to my home, and go to their house for dinner and everything, but not that we didn't hang around cafes or anything. Well, one summer we had a contest at the swimming pool. And every good-looking girl that came around, we asked her to sit in a plaster of Paris mold. Then we voted as to who had the best behind, and I made this chair and copied it exactly. She sat and she said, "I'm not that big," and I said, "You are when you sit down spread out." But anyway, it's kind of interesting and very comfortable. I'm a storyteller. I'm not an artist. I refer to artists as painters. And the mere fact that somebody says your work is an artist, I don't think my work is artistic at all. A German director called Murnau came over and he'd made a very good picture. And he used all the tricks in the world and it was rather intriguing to watch. So I made one picture with all the tricks in it. And they liked it so much, the studio did, that they held it about a year. And by that time, everybody had done the same things that I did. So I gave it up, and from that time on, I've just shot it the way you see a thing. I shoot straight forward, too. I don't use any camera tricks or anything. Camera usually is eye height, and the audience sees just what we see. Well, I resent camera movement that starts in doing what you ought to be able to do. A camera that goes dollying up to show somebody's face and have them smirk or grin or scowl or something, I think is kind of ridiculous. When they do it so that you become conscious of it. How do you look at a thing? Do you lie on the ground and look up and see it? Or do you get up on top of a stepladder and look down? You just look at a thing. If you were telling a story, would you go flashing back in the middle of it and say, "Well, now, I've told you this, but I'll tell you what happened 20 years ago"? And that doesn't interest me if I can't tell a story the way it is and I don't want to tell it. I've never been afraid of telling people what to do. I don't make a lot of noise, and if there's something wrong with somebody in the scene, I walk up to them and tell them very quietly what's wrong. I always look through the camera, but I tell him what I want before we start a scene. You'll find that the best of the directors, especially the older ones, were storytellers. They worked on their scenarios. It became part of the way that they did stories that could be recognized. Any of the good ones, you can tell in a moment who directed it. I think Hitchcock is, you can tell right away that he, what happened. I think with Capra, you could tell. I think with Stevens. And any of those fellows, they worked on their own stuff. And they didn't make a scene till they thought it was good. So I stick to people that I know. I know how they talk. And I made a number of pictures with people with accents. But I made sure that their accent was understandable and only used about one-third of what they would have liked to have used. Like Scarface, like Edward Robinson playing a Greek fisherman. It doesn't pay to try and make something about somebody that you don't know. I have a favorite of getting a good story that I can tell. I haven't made a comedy in quite a while for a simple reason. I haven't found a story. Westerns are tough to find. The easiest story to find is a plain dramatic story, such as Bogart and To Have and To Have Not, The Big Sleep. They're the easiest. I call those wheelchair jobs. I think a professional knows that death is going to come and it's going to happen to everybody, and they just don't believe in making a big to-do about it. They suffer when a friend is killed, but they don't do it openly. No, they're not afraid of a bit of dying. They know that that's going to come eventually, so why not now? Plane engine quits and you're up in the air, you don't know whether you're going to get down all right. When you start spinning a race car, you don't know how that spinning is going to end. Sometimes it could come from people. I was making a scene in Viva Villa on a railroad cut with tracks down below, and some goof came running out and shoved a pistol at me and started to yell something. I don't know what it was. I turned and hit him. He went over. He lived on the railroad tracks. I never heard whether he died or whether his skull was broken open or not. I wasn't interested. One time, Ernest Hemingway phoned me. And he said, Howard, I got drunk last night, and I made a silly bet. So you have to come down and help me. And I flew down there, and I said, what'd you do in this bet? And he said, well, these two fellows are the Cuban champions. And you've got $10,000 up, and I've got $10,000 up. And I said, you must have been pretty tight. My wife went down with me, and I taught her how to shoot. And when I saw what they were going to do, they were going to shoot live birds in thrown by bent steel out, and you had to hit them before they got over a certain little low fence. I said, this isn't quite fair. I've never shot this kind of stuff before. And very snide Cubans said, well, we'll throw in your lovely wife on your side. And I said, okay, would you like to double the bet? She never missed a bird, and I only missed one, and we won all our money from her. I make all my pictures at least 20% faster than the average person. If the actor can't do a scene, well, I let him do a scene. If it's 200 feet long, I say, do it in 150 feet. And if he can't do it, then we just stay there until he can. The audience gets so far ahead of you that you don't have to do a lot of explaining. You don't have to do a lot of things. They're right with you. I've never made anything that I thought was too good for an audience. In a Western, they asked me how I liked a certain man's work, and I said, hell, I can shoot three men and take them to the graveyard and bury them by the time that he gets one man down to the ground, because he goes into slow motion stuff and everything. I just don't believe in it. I think the audiences are too smart. If you get an audience of 1,000 people in a theater, they're going to be quite a bunch that'll get it way before anybody else. And so you make pictures for the ones that get it quickly. They start to laugh, and then the other people join with them. You get the speed by the... It used to be an old axiom with actors that they didn't overlap the other man's line. They didn't spoil the other man's line. And in the first picture that I tried it, I had a good deal of trouble because I said, why don't you overlap that fellow's line? Well, they said he wouldn't like it. And I said, it's what I like. I mean, I don't give a damn whether he doesn't like it or not. If I can't understand his lines, then I'll make you do it over again. And it would usually take an actor who came into the picture 2 days to get up to the speed of the picture. Really, the first time we tried it for speed was in His Girl Friday. And then we wrote the dialogue so that the first few lines, first few words of a line, we didn't need. And the last few words we didn't need, so that the overlapping gave an appearance, a feeling of being fast. And actually it wasn't. It was just the fact that two people. But if you and I were talking, I would butt into you and you'd butt into me, and that's a natural way of doing it. And if the audience can't follow it, then they're not paying much attention, and it doesn't make any difference anyway. just happens that the audiences like the stories that I like, and they like the people that I put in them. So, that's all there is to it. I was just born lucky about that. Well, I like so many things. I've flown about 10,000 hours and owned about 15 airplanes. Broken quite a few records flying for speed flying.
Fliegen lernte Hawks 1917 als Soldat.
The teacher took me up and he said, "Do you know anything about it?" And I said, "Yes, I've had about an hour flying." He said, "Can you land this airplane?" And I said, "Yes." Yeah. I landed and he said, "Let me find out whether that was an accident and do it again." So I landed another time and he said, "You're an instructor from now." And I said, "Do you know what this makes? A little under an hour and three quarters." He said, "That's a whole lot better than a lot of us have." We had 7,000 cadets down there and about six people to teach them how to fly. So it was very interesting. And that started me getting interested in flying.
Ein Flug mit seinem Freund Howard Hughes.
People don't realize that he built the fastest pursuit plane, faster than England, Germany, or anybody had, and flew it himself. I went with him the day he flew it. He called me and asked me to come down. I said, "What do you want?" "I want you to get back in your airplane and start down full speed, and I'll start off, and you can watch me when I take off, and if anything happens, you can know just what happened." So I got back a couple of miles and got up to top speed, and as I was coming up to the field, I saw him take off and start. And beforehand, I told him, "If anything happens, there's a bean field out there. Land in the bean field." "How?" he said. I said, with wheels up, you just slide in. Well, the cockpit cover blew off the airplane, and I knew he didn't have any goggles or helmet or anything on him. He had about 400 or 500 mile an hour airspeed. He landed in the bean field, slid to a stop, got out, waved to me. I went over and got a car and came back to get him. "What made you say to land in the bean field?" I said, "Well," I said, "because two or three fellows were a lot better flyers than I am." "I landed in a bean field and it's a great place to slide in." He said, "It's a marvelous place."
Über die Fliegerei drehte Hawks The Air Circus, The Dawn Patrol, Ceiling Zero, Only Angels Have Wings und zuletzt 1943 Air Force, die Geschichte einer B-17 und ihrer Besatzung im Pazifik.
A good friend of Arnold, the head of our Air Force, he asked me to make the picture. He gave me all the data that they had. He assigned a couple of officers to me, and anything we wanted, we got. And they had a rule that pursuit planes shouldn't come below 800 feet. I had them down taking the tops off palm trees. So I had a really good time making that picture, and we had some good flying in it. Well, people have said that they're all a lot the same. They asked me why I use them, and I said, "That's the kind of a girl I like. That's the only kind that interests me." I think it's been said that they're like the new woman's lib thing, but they don't talk as much as the people today do. They just act that way. I mean, and because of the fact that I like them that way, I've tailored and chosen people to act that way. I don't like the
very feminine girl who's in pink and baby blue and curls and prim and everything. They don't interest me at all. I like an honest, forthright girl. So that shows up in the pictures.
Mit Humphrey Bogart und Lauren Bacall drehte Hawks zwei Filme.
When Bacall fell in love with Bogart, and he with her, and she told me about it, I said, I'll tell you one thing. I wouldn't be surprised if he wasn't in love with the girl in the scenario. And if I were you, and if you're smart, and if you love him, you better keep on acting this way all the time. And every time I meet her, she says, I'm still doing the same thing. And it's become part of her thinking. And she is like that. That's what made her great.
Lauren Bacall wurde von Hawks entdeckt. Zusammen mit Bogart machte sie für ihn Haben und Nichthaben und Tote schlafen fest.
Quite a number of girls, I got very tired of using women stars. They always come up to you for a picture and say, the right side of my face is much better than the left. Will you just use the right side? And I'd say, no, I'm not going to worry about it. But it did make me want to get a new girl who didn't have any of those things and let the audience see a new girl. So I started an awful lot of new girls.
Auch die schöne Carol Lombard hatte unter Hawks Regie 1934 ihren ersten großen Erfolg.
She was a second cousin of mine, came from the same little town in Wisconsin. When I did rather well, she came out here because she wanted to act. She came frequently to the house, and she was delightful because she was a complete extrovert. She just did and said anything that she felt like doing. And she was so beautiful and so well-dressed that she'd get by with it. So I needed an actress, and I couldn't get one to play with Barrymore in 20th Century. And I thought of Carol, and I told the head of the studio I'd like to use Carol Lombard. And he said, oh, my God, you can get somebody better than that. And I said, okay, get somebody better. So he came in a week and he said, I made a deal to get Carol Lombard. And she came over and worked. And the day we started, I told Barrymore, I said, now look, I don't care what happens out on the set. I don't want any squawks from you until 2 o'clock in the afternoon. In the meantime, it's all on me, and I don't want you to do anything. He said, okay. And they went into their first scene. He was holding his nose behind her back, and she was pretty bad. She was really awful bad. So I told the cameraman to say that there'd be a 20-minute delay while they fixed some things. And I took Carol for a walk. I said, Carol, you've been working pretty hard on this, haven't you? And she said, I'm glad it shows. And I said, yes, you know your lines perfectly. How much do you get paid for doing this picture? She said, $5,000. And I said, that's pretty good. She said, I thought it was great. I said, what do you get paid for? Well, she said, acting, of course. And I said, supposing I tell you that you earned the $5,000 this morning, you don't know a goddamn cent. And she stared at me. I said, what would you do if a man said such and such a thing to you? She said, I'd kick him right in the balls. Well, I said, Barrymore said that. Why didn't you kick him? And she just stared at me. And I said, what would you do if a man did such and such a thing? And she made typical Lombard gesture with her, you know. I said, well, he did that. Why didn't you do that? And I said, we're going to go back in there, and if you don't kick him right where you said you were, if you don't wave your arms, if you don't do any goddamn thing you can think of, if you don't stop acting, I'm going to throw you right out of here and get another girl, and I won't give you more than a couple of hours to learn. And she said, you're serious, aren't you? And I said, I'm awful serious. Okay, she said, if that's what you want. And we went back in, and I said, we're going to make a take. And Barrymore said, wait a minute, we're not ready yet. And I said, who's running this thing? And he said, you are. They had a 12-page scene. They started the scene. She made a kick at him. He protected himself and started talking this way. She waved her arms. He chased her backwards until she sat on a couch that was in there, and she had her feet up in the air and was kicking at him. They played 12 pages of dialogue and never missed a one. They got better and better as it went along, and finally he made an exit speech and stalked out. And I said, cut, print it. And he came back in and he said, that was magnificent. Have you been kidding me all the time? And she burst into tears and ran off the stage. And he said, Hart, what the hell goes on around here? And I told him about it. Only he said, it's hard to believe, but she's going to be a star. She's a cinch. She's going to be a star. And I said, she will if you keep working with her, you know, and everything. He helped her, and she was a star.
Carol Lombard und John Barrymore in Napoleon von Broadway.
Well, I'm interested in watching a scene, and if the scene is good, I go ahead and make it. And if it seems to lack something, I try to find out what it is and supply it. If it seems dull in the spot, I try to change it. If it needs movement, I try to put movement. Very often working with John Wayne, I say, what the devil's the matter with you? He says, something's wrong about this scene. And you know he's generally right. We find out what it is. I can change it, give him new dialogue in 5 minutes. Then he grins and he says, okay, let's go. And we go ahead with the scene.
In Red River, spielt John Wayne den Rancher Tom Dunson.
And John Wayne kept saying, how do I play an old man? And I say, well, we come to it, Duke. And we finally came to the scene of where he was. We were sitting on a hilltop or the side of a hill. Cattle were coming around us and through, and he said, now look, you got to tell me how to play an old man. And I said, watch me get up, Duke. And I got up from the ground, and Duke said, I know now how to do it. And I never had to tell him another thing about it, because he didn't have to do a lot of acting and like an old man or anything. He just had to show his age and the way he got up and the things that he did.
Mit seinem Lieblingsschauspieler Cary Grant drehte Hawks unter anderem die Komödien Leoparden küsst man nicht, Sein Mädchen für besondere Fälle, Ich war eine männliche Kriegsbraut und Liebling, ich werde jünger.
Well, Cary Grant was the very prolific man at suggestions. One scene I remember, he had to get mad, and he said, what do you think? And I said, I think it's dull. I said, you're getting mad just like everybody does. He started to laugh, and he said, I know a fellow who, he'd whinny like a horse, like that when he got mad. And I said, do that. And he did it all the way through the picture.
In Hawks' legendärem Gangsterfilm Scarface von 1930 spielt George Raft einen kleinen Gangster.
George was an utterly inexperienced actor. I saw him in a prize fight. He had a great face. He had a good deal of poise and everything, but he didn't know what to do with his hands or anything. I had read that in Chicago, as a mark of disdain, they would put a coin in a dead man's hand. So I got half dollars and started George, and he, whenever he was in doubt of what to do, he could toss that coin. It was really, he did it very well and made a different actor out of him. I don't start choosing characters until
really make a character out of all the people who are important in the picture. And switch them around and make them the way I like to have them. Come and get it. The Edna Ferber story was about a little lame girl who sang so badly that she was hooted off the stage. I put Frances Farmer in, and she was one of the lustiest, sexiest girls going. For Westerns, I like to have a crotchety, nasty old man, like Walter Brennan played. I can tell you a story about Walter Brennan. I had a very smart assistant director who came in and he said, "You know, you described a man the other day. I don't know whether he'd work or not. He's never had. No, he's just an extra man. He doesn't act much." Well, I said, "Do you think he's good?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "Okay, will you get him into costume and give him some lines and save me two or three interviews?" He brought in Walter Brennan. I looked at him, I started to laugh. I said, "Mr. Brennan, have they given you some lines?" "Yes." I said, "Do you want to read them with me?" And he said, "Well, I'd like to." I said, "Well, go ahead." And he said, "With or without?" And I said, "With or without what?" And he said, "False teeth." And so that made me laugh, and I said, "Without." And he turned around, put his teeth in his pocket. I hired him, and he was supposed to work 3 days, and I had him work 7 weeks. Just made the character work all the way through. And I made 5 pictures with him, I think, and he got 3 Academy Awards and was nominated the other 2 times. And he didn't have a part. But all you had to do was look at him, and you could give him a part.
Walter Brennan spielte in 6 Hawks-Filmen. Zuerst in Küste der Gesetzlosen, später unter anderem in Red River und Rio Bravo.
I like the kind of ground that we're in around here. Uneven ground and bushes and everything. This is typically Western, the kind of things that we used a lot in El Dorado. I like rocks. You can make all kinds of scenes. You can make good chase scenes. You can make good scenes of falling. So this is very good. The thing that I hate is flat ground. I look for places near hills where the clouds gather. The more bad weather we get, the better the cameraman and I like it. And I like to be out of doors. I spent all my life being out of doors. And I like the pictures that are built around that. I like the Westerns. I like the things like Atari. Any chance I can get off the stage, I do.
Hawks und sein 23-jähriger Sohn Greg.
And then, of course, I built or worked on the cars that my boy drive. And he finally ended up by winning 50 races in 1 year. And he said, "Pop, this is no fun. I can beat all these people." So I said, "What do you want to do?" And he said, "I don't know." And I said, "Do you want to ride motorcycles?" And he said, "Yes." And I thought, "I'm going to ride a motorcycle." And within 6 months, he was riding with the professionals.
And he learned to drive down in Africa on a dry lake down there in a Jeep. And he got so that he didn't mind spinning, going in a complete spin, get out of them and things like that. And really that made him a good one. Today he's one of the best drivers there in the high desert for the Baja race.
Like that other truck went past me, and I took the same lines he did, you know, right behind him. He just kept gaining on me. You know, he just had more horsepower, plus it probably handles a little better.
I've had such a good time in my life that it wouldn't bother me a bit if I died at any time. I had too good a time to wish it was different.
Why?
Well, I don't know. I've always done what I wanted. I've accomplished what I wanted to accomplish. And that goes for work and for play and everything. So I've had a hell of a good life.